you turn darkness into light, blindness into sight. Hallelujah, you will never change. You're everything we need. We declare you, there is none.
Let's stand to our feet this morning and sing that song, Trading My Sorrows. Church, we're going to slow things down this morning. We're going to lift our voices and our hands and sing this song, Here I Am to Worship.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see.
Sing that last song, take me past the outer courts.
Take me past the outer courts and through the holy place, past the brazen altar. Lord, I want to see your face. Pass me by the crowds of people and the priests who sing your praise. I hunger and I thirst for
take me in
and take me in.
We want to go before the Lord. We're praying for a number of needs. Believing God, there's a Jacoby who has addiction issues, needs God to touch him and to save him. There's an Ashley who's pregnant, praying for safe delivery there. We're praying for Brian Kilpatrick, needs to be saved and God to move in his life. We're praying for Chuck. He has surgery tomorrow and just want to believe God to overshadow him, help him in a quick recovery. We're going to pray for him at the end of the service, as well as for Cobra and her dad, who's going through just a number of medical issues. Richard Paola, I want to pray for him as well. We're praying for our Pat Agustinelli, God's grace and healing virtue upon her. Doctors would finally get and figure out what it is so they can treat it right, or just do a total miracle and help her in that. We're praying for Bob Gansler, believing God to touch him, help him. We're praying for the team that is down in the South. They're going to be visiting. They're in Jacksonville. They had 17 visitors last night, one person saved, and the church is very encouraged with that. Good things are happening. They're going to be doing the play there tonight, and then they'll be going on, which will include jaunts up to Virginia and as far south as South Carolina. And so just want to pray for them, traveling mercies, lots of miles. Believe God to help them and to be with them on this impact team, and lots of people getting saved. We're praying for our upcoming revival with Tony Chase that begins next week. Really excited about that. Just pray God's grace, glory. We're praying for word in due season. We're praying for visitors, people to get saved, God to do a mighty work in our midst. We're also praying and believing God for our mother church in Prescott, believing God to just touch them and help them, be with them and overshadow all that's happening there. Now all that Pastor Greg is involved in, with many, many conferences going on right now, I want to pray for them. We're praying for leadership churches as well. We're praying for the LaValleys up in Toronto, believing God to help them, their staff, believing God just to move, do a mighty work there as they're gearing up for their first conference, their second conference in May. Praying for Cape Cod, their staff there, Pastor Campo, and all that's going on there as they're gearing up for their conference in April. And then, of course, Jacksonville, North Carolina, they have their conference in just a couple of weeks. I want to pray, believe God, for great things there. We're also praying and believing God to pour out His Spirit upon our outreach churches tomorrow. Matt Stoll has a meeting. We're praying that God's grace would be upon him, that this would be the final meeting. I think it's his fourth meeting. He was expecting to just have this done by mid-February, and here we are into March, and this drags out as, you know, they nitpick certain little things, and so just pray that this will go and be resolved very quickly. Tomorrow night, 7 o'clock, praying God's grace there, praying for the Van Epps in Greece, the Harrises in Rockport. Praying as well, believing God to move in our city, our nation, all that He wants to do, and helping us in revival, the government, those who put themselves in harm's way, the war in Ukraine, the victims of the earthquake in Syria and in Turkey. Pray that that's an open door for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Many times humanitarian workers, it's amazing how the Islamic community, they're very slow to respond to these things, but it's the Christian nations, Christian communities that are very fast. So praying God's grace and open doors for that, for the gospel to go forth there. How many of you have needs in your heart? You lift them up, speak them out. We're going to believe God for great things. I'm going to ask Yanni to come seal us in prayer. Let's go before the Lord. Father, right now, God, we're asking you, God, for your grace in your hand, your dominion and your glory right now in the name of Jesus Christ. God, I'm asking you, God, for your favor, God, that breaks the strongholds, oh God, a healing virtue upon our sister Pat, our brother Bob, God. I'm asking you right now for grace, God. Lord, upon the team, God, give them mercies, traveling grace, God, be with them.
Father God, we come before you, God, this morning. We're asking that you would touch, God, the sickened body right now in the name of Jesus. God, that you would go before everyone that is having surgery. Oh, God, that you would have your way, God, that there would be quick recovery. We're asking that you would give comfort to the family. Oh, God, we're asking that you would move in our land, our city specifically, in our new converts. God, that you would bring breakthrough. God, conversions, repentance. God, we desperately need you to move, God, in our land. God, we pray for our leadership. God, give them a wisdom and favor, God, in all that they do. God, that you would have your hand upon their lives, God, their body of people. God, we pray for our pioneer workers, God, that as they are out there laboring, God, that you would do supernatural miracle, that your Holy Spirit would go beyond them, my God, that there would be conversions and fruit that remains. God, we pray for this a service, God, that we would move in our hearts, that you would speak to us. And then also we pray for our team down south, God, that you would have your traveling mercies, God, that you would bring an anointing and that lives would be transformed through that play. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And take a moment, greet one another, share the victory of God. Morning service. We're very glad that you are with us this morning. Really do count it a privilege. Just want to let you know some things we've got going on here. We're very excited about tonight. 4:30, we do have a serious men's class, and so look forward to that. It's going to be a little different, and so, but just be excited about that. 4:30 this evening, then 5 o'clock will be our prayer meeting, 6 o'clock our Sunday evening service. Wednesday, we will be having our midweek service. at 7 o'clock, prayer meeting at 6 o'clock, and that's going to be a great time. Then next Sunday, we begin revival with Pastor Evangelist Tony Chase, and really excited about that. It's going to be a great time. It'll be the 12th in both our Sunday morning, Sunday evening service, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, 7 o'clock. So look forward to that. It's going to be a great, great time in Jesus. And then also just want to let you know that the Northeast Bible Conference, April 10th through the 14th, on Cape Cod, that will be, the sign-up list is out. There's also either a telephone number or a QR code if you'd like to use that for the hotel. They're not able to open any houses. COVID probably really finished that, any opportunity for that. But if you're interested in going to that, there's a sign-up list there. Also, you can make reservations using either the telephone number or the QR code, and all the information is on the sign-up list there. And so looking forward to what God is going to do. Then May 8th through the 12th, that will be the Canadian Bible Conference, and we will be having information on that shortly. May 20th and 21st. May 20th will be a Saturday. We will be having a dinner with Pastor Eric Strutz, the man who pioneered the church in the continuation of our celebration of 40 years here. And so we'll have a slight, it'll be a low-key event as far as meals. We might get some pizzas or something like that. But he's going to tell his story of Rochester and his experiences here, what he had there. And then on the 21st, he'll be ministering in both our Sunday morning, Sunday evening services. And so look forward to that. Amen. That is all the announcements we have. We want to hear a report. We had an outreach yesterday, and Brian Northrup's going to come and tell us what the Lord did.
Good morning, everybody. Yesterday, we had a pretty good outreach. We went to Eastview Mall, and we evangelized. We told people about Jesus, told our testimonies to different people in the mall. If you're available, 11 a.m. on Saturday mornings, we have an organized outreach that we go out in the local areas and tell people about Jesus. It's really encouraging to see just people open to the gospel, especially in our city where we reside. And so yesterday, we just again went to the mall, told people about Jesus, and Yanni actually got a total open door to talk to this kid. And I think he was about 26 years old, very open. He got to pray with that kid. And then Yanni was telling me the testimony of it. And then he said, oh, he's right there. And then the kid came up to us and he's like, can I hang out with you? And he just hung out with us on our way out to the cars. And so his name's Robbie, I think. Was it Robbie? So pray for Robbie. Total open door. The seed's been planted. And we're just going to be in prayer for not just Robbie, but other people on outreach who have prayed recently. Let's just keep them in prayer. It's another dimension with follow-up. So let's keep that in prayer as well and see what God can do in these people's lives. So give God praise for that.
Thank God. Also, my daughter lives over in Holland, and she and her husband were just at the Holland Bible Conference. And they planted three international churches, including one into Switzerland, one into the islands that are in the south, in the Indian Ocean, and a church into India, as well as two churches in Holland. And so great, great excitement for what God is doing there. And we're very privileged to be a part of that and to know that God is on the move. God is about to, as I ministered Wednesday, I believe the storm clouds on the horizon for revival. All that's happening right now, we're about to step into something mighty. And so you remember your tithes, your offerings besides, and let God bless your life. Steve, would you ask God to bless you on the gift and the giver?
You turn sorrow into peace, despair into belief. Hallelujah, you would never. You turn darkness, you turn darkness.
darkness into light, blindness into sight. Hallelujah, you're
everything.
You're everything we need. There is none.
Thank you, platform workers. Appreciate it. A little thin based on the fact that the team's away, but they did a great job this morning, and so appreciate that. This morning, Romans chapter 4, if you have your Bibles. Romans chapter 4. I have to explain this to some of the younger people here. Back in the last century, I guess is the best way to describe it, we didn't have all the digital stuff that you've got. And a lot of our music was on a thing called a cassette tape. And cassette tapes, they were a little big. They could twist. They could break. You ever have to crack it? If you ever had cassette tapes, sometimes you had to crack it to get it to the wheel to unstick. Sometimes you could tell when your tape was getting eaten by the tape player because all of a sudden it would start getting gobbled. And you're going, no! And you hit the... Stella, when Weldell was a young girl in the 1990s, and she had all her music, what they would call a mixed cassette, her favorite songs. She was from England. Her family had taken a vacation to Spain, and like many 12-year-olds do, she lost her cassette when they were in Spain on the beach somewhere. And of course, she was sad about that, but life went on. Stella was shocked to find that it was found more than two decades later and ended up in a Stockholm exhibit. The exhibit was based on plastics in the sea and how they don't disintegrate and But the amazing thing about this, the tape had been recovered by a UK artist, Mandy Barker, who was finishing up this art exhibit to be shown in Stockholm, Sweden. It was called Sea of Artifacts. And what was very interesting is that except for the first couple of songs on the tape, it was playable. And they began to show that plastics could last a long time at sea and whatever. But what was amazing to me is that something she had lost, 20 years later, she was able to find. In the text we're going to read, Abraham has been given a promise. That promise has taken a long time to fulfill. It took 25 years from the time he was given the promise to the time it was fulfilled. And in that time, as time passes, we can begin to forget about promises that we were given, things that we've lost. We're getting older, life's changing, circumstances have happened that have not been the way we thought they should play out. And as a result, we begin to feel that dreams or purposes or desires are lost. And we wonder if we can ever get them back. I want to look with you at Romans 4, beginning in verse 16. Going on through verse 25, this is Paul writing about a man named Abraham. So the promise is received by faith. It was given as a free gift. And we are all certain to receive it. Whether or not we live according to the law of Moses, it
if we have faith like Abraham, for Abraham was the father of all who believed. That is what the scripture means when God told him, I have made you the father of many nations. This happened because Abraham believed in the God who brings the dead back to life, who creates new things out of nothing. Even when there was no reason for hope, Abraham kept hoping, believing that he would become the father of many nations. For God had said to him, that is how many descendants you will have. And Abraham's faith did not weaken, even though he was about 100 years of age. He figured his body was as good as dead, and so was Sarah's womb. Abraham never wavered in believing God's promise. In fact, he grew stronger. And in this, he brought glory to God. He was fully convinced that God is able to do what he promises. And because Abraham's faith, God counted it to him as righteousness. And when God counted it as righteousness, it wasn't just for Abraham's benefit. It was recorded for our benefit too, assuring us that God will also count righteousness if we believe in the one who raised Jesus from the dead and handed him over to die because of our sins, who was raised to life that he might make us right with God. I want to talk to you firstly about the creeping reality of unbelief. This is not just something that happens one day. There are people that maybe will go through a traumatic experience and it shatters their faith. But most of us, most people will deal with the fact that unbelief is creeping. And what I say by that is when people first get saved, man, they could believe God for everything. I mean, nothing is impossible. We know that. We read that. Nothing but my God, nothing is impossible. We know that God can do everything. We're convinced if he's able to save us, draw us in, the dirty sinner that we were, the rejected, you know, rejecting God, sometimes even fighting against him, mocking him, that he saves us. And we're like, wow, if he could do that, he can do just about anything. But then life begins to happen. Right? We live life, and as Pastor Mitchell would say all the time, you have to live life to the end. You can't just point back and say, well, I did this, this, and that. You have to keep going to the end. But think about this, because Abraham dealt with many of these as well. First of, we have failures. You're going to be serving God for any length of time, you're going to fail from time to time. That's going to be a reality. Sometimes that might be a sin. Sometimes that just might be a bad judgment call. Sometimes that's a bad decision we make. Abraham had some times like that. As soon as he's given the promise that your seed will be great, he goes into the land and there's a famine. There's circumstances that has conspired against him. And now he, rather than stays in the land that God had promised him, he then runs down to Egypt. Well, he's on his way to Egypt, he takes a look at Sarah and goes, man, you're beautiful. This is going to be a problem. They're going to kill me and take you as your wife. So you tell them you're my sister. And to my amazement, Sarah let him live. And they do this. And the king in Egypt goes, hey, sister, right? Okay, come on into my harem. But then there's problems there. And in the problems, it's believed that many of his Pharaoh's wives either couldn't get in Egypt, they in the court, they couldn't get pregnant, or they were miscarrying. And so Abraham prays, his wife is restored to him. God spares him, has to visit Abimelech in a dream, and God helps him through that time. But I can imagine that, you know, seven lambs were given to Sarah as kind of a parting gift to kind of remind, hey, you lied about this. Had to deal with their failure. He would go on to lie about her as his wife again and say, she is my sister. They were in frustration. Years had gone by with the promise. I think it was 12 or 13 years had gone by, and they hadn't seen Sarah get pregnant. And this frustration began to boil up, especially in Sarah. And she said, hey, I've got this idea. I've got this young girl named Hagar. She's my servant. Why don't you have a child with her? And sure enough, Hagar gets pregnant, gives birth to a child named Ishmael. Ishmael becomes a problem. First, Sarah sends her away as the child, and God tells Hagar to go back. She goes back, and then finally, again, when they circumcise Isaac and he's mocking Isaac, they send him away, and she never does return. But this was a major mistake. And so in life, past failures, which you can note doesn't stop the plan of God, doesn't stop the purposes of God, and didn't stop the promises of God. But they were there, and sometimes we go through a few things and we're like, oh, God promised me that before my mistake, failure, issue, whatever. Also, there's the passing of time. It says in our text in verse 19 that Abraham's faith did not weaken, even though he was about 100 years old and figured his body was as good as dead. And so was Sarah's womb. Time had gone on. Circumstances look very bad towards that. And so he's going on. 25 years have gone by since the promise. Some people, it's time, as time goes on. We kind of expect we get a word, we get a promise, God speaks to us, we expect it to kind of happen very quickly. We expect the fast track, we expect the line. We don't, you know, when we're driving somewhere, we don't expect traffic, but then we find out that there's a lot of things that can slow us down. And so in life, there's things slow us down. Some of this may have been on Abraham, but time goes on. It's a kind of an amazing transition. There's one chapter that ends and literally says, and Abraham was 86 years old. And the next chapter begins, and when Abraham was 99 years old. That those 13, 14 years are gone. We don't know what happened in the midst of those, what was all transpiring, it just probably was serving God, but time goes on. And there's times, there's gaps where in our lives it feels like nothing is really happening. God made a promise, but it doesn't look like anything's moving forward towards that. This is why the apostle would write Galatians 6:9, let us not be weary in doing good, for just at the right time we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. Why? Because there are time gaps. God doesn't always move in our time frames. We want him to move. We want him to do something. We want something to happen. And it's not happening when we want it to happen. The danger of many people like this is they begin to get bitter. Bitter people destroy often their own lives simply by, because they're mad, they're disappointed, unrealistic expectations. Bitterness is the poison that people drink and wait for others to die. And they wonder why it doesn't begin to work well for them. This can happen even towards God. God, you promised. God, you told me. And now it's God's fault. But God didn't give up on the promise, but this can happen. Unanswered prayers. People have prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed for something to happen. And it didn't happen when they wanted it or how they wanted it. And sometimes it's impossible for it to ever happen. Maybe they prayed for an unsaved loved one to get saved, and then they pass away. God, you could have, and people begin to get bitter towards God. Their expectations of life begin to get fairly lowered. Well, it didn't work out, so I guess I have to settle for less. I have to settle for less. I have to settle for less. You actually see this in Abraham's life when when Sarah says, I guess I'm not going to be the one. I guess you need to take Hagar. This is settling for less. God told him, no, that's not the way I meant it. Sarah's going to be the one. That's the way it's going to work. But in this, expectations. I've seen people actually change their theology. Change who they expect God to be because they're disappointed. I've seen people actually literally backslide because God didn't do it the way they wanted him to do it. They get bitter at God. People who get like this get very defensive, very self-righteous, very selfish. You see this in their lives because they have to protect what they have left. And what others, when someone else is blessed, when someone else receives favor from God, they get angry and more upset. You see this in life, you see this in people's hearts. In our text, it tells us that these don't have to finish you off. They don't have to be the end of you. Reclaiming or laying hold again of the promises. It tells us in our text in verses 20 and 21 that he did not waver at the promises through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God, being fully convinced that what he had promised, he was also able to perform. Strengthened in faith. That's kind of a fascinating term. The Amplified Bible says, fully satisfied and assured that God was able and mighty to keep his word to that which he had promised. So the question then becomes is, who is your God? Who is the one whom you serve? Is it the God that you had when you were a new convert that could do anything and everything? Or has he shrunk down to not be able to overcome circumstances and even our personal failures? When this begins to happen, some people begin to get double-minded. James tells us that when you ask him, be sure that you ask in faith in God alone. And do not waver, for a person who is divided loyalties will always be unsettled as a wave in the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. Such people should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Their loyalty is divided between God and the world. They are unstable in everything they do. So is it God who's going to take care of it? Or is it you? And when it becomes you, then your faith is in you and God shrinks. When you have to fix it, when you always have to be the one to set things right and in order, and it going back and forth, you end up accomplishing nothing for God in life. There's no satisfaction. There's no peace. And the personal promises to your life become, God's going to help you. Yeah, we'll see. God can do. Yeah, we'll see. That's a very dangerous place to be with the promises of God, because what eventually is, you can talk yourself out of it. Words are powerful. And how you speak about God and the things of God are very powerful. Because as Jesus said, what's in the heart comes through the words. Or the old expression, what's in the well comes up in the bucket. And so you can begin to tell where people's faith are at, just how they talk. As soon as something happens, oh, I knew it was bad, I knew it was over, I did, you know. You just dropped your paper, that's all. Pick it up, go on, man. But some people, as soon as something happens, they are absolutely convinced that it's all bad, always going to be that way. You can tell by their words, because their God is so small, they're the ones who have to fix it. Faith in God, it says Abraham in our text, never wavered in believing God's promise. In fact, he grew stronger. How? He brought glory to God. Do those words bring glory to God? Would you be pleased with God if he was standing right there and heard those words? See, that changes how we speak. Faith is energized by words, so is unbelief. But it's really, they're strengthened more and more. Dealing with an individual recently, and she is kind of obsessing on one issue, and she keeps talking about it, and it gets bigger. She talks about it and gets bigger. She talks about it and gets bigger. She talks about it and gets bigger. I'm like, and it's something that will never happen. Never happen. But she's beginning to grow it in her mind. Words we speak begin to grow things in our mind. As we speak, it reveals what we're expecting. It's the energy of life. Words reveal the heart. This is where faith comes from, where unbelief comes from. Hebrews 11, 13 and 14. All these people died still believing what God had promised them. They did not receive what was promised, but they saw it from a distance and welcomed it. They agreed that they were foreigners and nomads on the earth. And obviously people who say such things are looking forward to a country that they can call their own. Words energize. It's amazing how many words we speak. It's like 50 or 60,000 a day on average, the average person. How many of those bring glory to God? How many of them lift up the name of Jesus, the things of God, the purposes of God? And then comes the issue of obedience. Abraham had to believe God. It tells us in our text that Abraham's faith did not weaken, that he was moving forward in this. And in the King James, it says that if we'll walk in the steps of Abraham, that God counted this for his righteousness. And this becomes very important to understand, because this has to do with obedience when you don't see the outcome. When it's not clear. When God tells you to do something, deals with your heart and mind, or it's clear in his word, and you can't see how that will work out, so you say no. I've seen people do this. I mentioned when I was in Lithuania that people thought, if I go to London, I can make more money. I could make more money, but I would tell them, you know what? You're stepping out of the will of God. You don't understand the dynamics. You'll be a foreigner in a foreign land. You're going to end up with menial jobs. You're going to end up with, oh, no, no, we can do it. Listen, London's more expensive. You have no idea how much more expensive it is. All they hear is the salaries. And everyone to a person who went to London chasing money ended up backsliding. Every one of them.
Some of them came back. Some of them we never heard from again. Obedience to God, even when you don't see the outcome. One couple stayed. He said, we could go to England. They both spoke better English than most Americans, as far as the King's English is concerned. And that they would have gone and they could have fit in and such, but they said, no, we're going to stay, do the will of God. They're blessed today, pastoring the church. Hebrews 11:15, if they had longed for this country that they came from, they could have gone back. Words will set desires in your life. As you speak, it will absolutely reveal what's in your heart. It will change your vision, how you see the promises of God. Verse 17 of our text says, and this is what the scripture meant when God told him, I've made you the father of many nations. And this happened to Abraham, who brings the dead back to life and who creates new things out of nothing. Either you'll face and focus on the obstacles, or you'll focus on the promises. And finally, it'll change your action. Faith without works is dead. Abraham obeyed God. Obedience has to be married to faith. They have to go together. If you're not obeying what God has told you to do, if you're not being obedient to the things of God, what the Bible says to do, then you cannot expect God to help you. You've put yourself in a place where you said you'll do it. But obedience requires us to be and do what God wants us to do. Let's talk about finally seeing the promises through. Because Abraham, he saw the promises, and eventually Isaac was born, which was the promise, and to their own mocking, I don't know if you understand this, but Isaac is named Laughter because at one time in the promise, they both were caught by the Lord laughing at the promise. And I think they named him Laughter to remind themselves of how good God is. That we laughed at this. And yet here it is. To get there, you have to first be content with your progress. There are a number of entries in Columbus's diary as he was sailing from Spain that all he said is, we sailed west. That's all it says. That's the whole entry for the day. Today we sailed west. When we woke up, could only see ocean. When we went to bed, only see ocean. But we're making progress. Nothing seemed to change, but it was happening. Philippians 1:6, and I am very certain that God, who began a good work within you, will continue his work until it is finally finished on the day when Christ Jesus returns. God has a work in your life. He has a plan. And if you'll be faithful to obey him and believe him, you'll see that come to pass. Sometimes you have to be a little discontented with the promises you're not seeing. And what I mean by that is that you don't just settle in and say, oh, I guess this is just the way it is. Remember, I was one time in prayer when I was pioneering, and, you know, I was making a whopping $6 an hour. And I went to my boss and I said, I just was in prayer that morning. I hadn't really talked to my wife about it. I hadn't really planned it. But I was in prayer. I'm like, God, you got to help me. And that day, my boss came up to me and we just started talking. And I said, hey, he complimented me. He said, you know, hey, you're doing a great job. I said, hey, listen. It's really tight. Is there anything you can do? And he went up to the office and he asked them, and I got a 50-cent raise, just like that.
Just because I just said, hey, and then we got another raise, which I actually went and asked him if he could take away because the raise pushed me into another tax bracket. And actually, even though they gave me 25 cents more an hour, it actually took like 28 cents an hour out of my check. So he said, okay, we'll fix that. And he moved it up again. Ended up with 4 raises in 2 months. I said, God, you promised you'd provide for me. God wants you to challenge him on his promise. He doesn't mind that. He doesn't mind if you get a little bit and say, God, I want to see what you promised me. Take it to God and bring it and say, God, show me, help me. God doesn't mind doing that. That's part of what Paul writes and means in Philippians 3:12. And I don't mean to say that I've already achieved these things or that I've already reached perfection, but I press on that I may that perfection for which Christ Jesus has possessed for me. Pressing on to having all that God has, the promises. And sometimes we just have to really dust off the old promises and reclaim them. Find them again. Visit them in our hearts, in our minds. Bring them to the altar and say, God, this is what you said you were going to do for me. Hebrews 6:11-12 says, for our great desire that you'll keep on loving others as long as you live, and in order to make that certain, what is your hope will come true. Then you will not be spiritually dull or indifferent. Instead, you will be following the example of those who are going to inherit God's promise because of their faith and their endurance. There are promises God has for us as a church, promises God has for you as an individual that you have to take to God and say, God, here it is. Reading a interesting little article, and this man was, he was talking about this store, Nordstrom's. And Nordstrom's has a policy that they will take back anything that's been purchased there. L.L. Bean has this same kind of policy. And the reality is many people don't take advantage of that. This man said about a year and a half ago, I bought a new navy blazer at Nordstrom's. It was one of those cases that you may have gone through that after buying an article of clothing, the more you wear it, the more you realize you don't like it. The blazer wasn't the right color, and to make matters worse, it was a style that was going out. After wearing it pretty much regularly for 6 months, I stuck it in the back of my closet, and I didn't wear it for a long time. Tucked in the back of my mind was the famous Nordstrom unconditional return policy. What I had thought about this off and on for a year and a half. I had worn it a number of times, and I thought there was no way they were going to take it back. But 2 weeks ago, I decided I had nothing to lose. I pulled out the blazer. Picked off the lint, he put on some lint to make it look bad, and went down to the Nordstrom's department store. I walked in, and immediately, I felt nervous. I felt like I was pulling a scam of some sort, played right out of a movie. I walked straight up to the first salesman I saw and I gave him my little prepared speech. I'm about to put your famous unconditional return policy to the ultimate test. I have a blazer here that I wore a lot, had it for a year and a half, but I don't like it. It's the wrong color. It attracts lint and it's going out of style. I want to return this blazer for another one. I couldn't believe what this big handlebarred mustached guy looked at me and said, for heaven's sakes, what took you so long? Let's go find a blazer. 10 minutes later, I walked out with another blazer that was marked $75 more than I had paid for the previous one. It was perfect. It didn't cost me a penny. He goes on in the article to say that God is like that. God makes promises that we have to believe and take Him up on. And that if we'll do that, God will help us tremendously. So the question then is, like Abraham, have you been given a promise? And you've written it off because of personal failures? Time? Circumstances? Can't happen. Time to take it to God, revisit that. Because God doesn't make promises He won't keep. He wants to help us. Let's bow our heads for just a moment. Maybe you're here this morning and you think, I'd love to have the promises of God, but I'm so far away from God. You don't understand all that I've done in life. You don't know all that I've been through, all that's happened, all that. And you may be right. I may not understand all of that. But God does. And one promise He's made to us, to every individual in here, is the promise of forgiveness. That if you'll simply come to God with all your hang-ups, all your problems, all who you are, and just simply come to an altar and say, this is my problem. I'm a sinner. I need Jesus to forgive me. I need God to help me. If that's you, the promise that God made is that He will not reject you. He will hear you, forgive you, and help you. And if you're here this morning, you're not right with God, you're not saved, you're not born again, or you're backslidden away from God, you want to receive the promises of God, I wonder if you'd slip up your hand and say, that's me. Would you pray for me? I'm not right with God. I'm not born again. I need Jesus. I'm away from God. I'm backslidden. I need to come back to Jesus. Anyone at all? Changing the call then to Christians, I want to ask you a question. What's your relationship with the promise of God? Are they still something in your life that you bring glory to God? Or are you speaking words on how this will never happen? How all the circumstances are conspiring against you? How this problem and that problem and my failure here and my failure there and his failure and her failure and you know, and all of this have conspired against, and I can't have the promises of God. Abraham grew in the promises of God, strengthened himself by the words to bring glory to God. And so that's a great place to revisit and begin to reestablish. Are our words bringing glory to God? God's going to help us. God's going to move if we'll simply allow Him to be who He is. Simply speak out, this is who He is, and this is how He's going to help me. And we're going to open up these altars. Let's stand. We're going to sing a song, worship His name, take me past the outer courts, give Him glory this morning. Talk to God about the promises.
Take me past the outer courts.
Tell Him you want to claim those again.
And through the holy place, past the blazing altar, Lord, I want to see Your face. Pass me by the crowds of people and the priest to sing Your praise.
Thank you.
God. Before we dismiss, I want to pray for Rich Kennedy, Chuck, and Kobe. You can come too, because I want to pray for Rich. His surgery goes well, and that God really helps him, and that he's able to recover quickly. I want to pray for Kobe. She's got now two people she has to take care of, as well as herself, and just she's going to need God's help and grace upon them. Stretch your hands towards this precious couple. Father, right now, God, we pray for Rich. I plead the blood of Christ, healing virtue, God. Guide the doctor's hands. Give them wisdom. God, blessing upon him right now, God. I plead the blood of Christ, God, for total healing from this hernia, God. I pray, God, Lord, a quick recovery, strength on his body. I pray you'd help him, God. Oh, God, in all the pain and everything that might come with it, God, I plead the blood of Christ right now. Healing virtue, God, help Cobra right now. Be with her, God, in every area of decision she has to make, God. Help her, God, bring healing to her body and bless her right now. Thank you for them in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank God. You keep Rich in his prayers. I'll tell you, I don't care if it's a back alley or it's an operating room. When someone comes at you with a knife, it is nervous business. And so keep him in your prayers for that. You remember our serious men tonight, 4:30, prayer meeting, 5 o'clock, service tonight, 6 o'clock. Let's bow our heads, go rejoicing in the goodness of God. And I'm going to ask if... Danny will close us in prayer.